first destination in the morning will be the Tsukiji Outer Market near Ginza, Tokyo. I can briefly give you the history of Tsukiji. Basically, this was a field land since 1657 in Edo, which is now called Tokyo. The land was reclaimed from Tokyo Bay and named Tsukiji, which literally means constructed land. In 1923, the Great Kanto earthquake destroyed central Tokyo, including the Nihonbashi Fish Market, which was relocated to Tsukiji in 1935, transforming it into a bustling, prosperous town. During Japan's robust economic growth in the 1980s, global interest in Japanese cuisine surged, making Tsukiji Market a popular destination for international visitors. The Tokyo Central Wholesale Market originally in Tsukiji has moved to another Tokyo location, while the surrounding shops known as the Tsukiji Outer Market remain in Tsukiji. And this is where we are heading this morning. Let's go. Let's take a look at the map here, and we stay at the Shinjuku Airbnb, and we have to walk from the Diamond Palace to the nearest subway station, Shinjuku Sankom Station, which is the red line at Marunouchi Line, and this would take us all the way to Ginza Station, and from here we can take a walk to the Tsukiji Outer Mall from here. So let's take a walk from the Ginza Station to the market. Today, the morning was excellent with a lot of sun. Unlike the day I arrived with quite a lot of rain, in contrast, it was kind of hot, and similarly to Toronto, it could differ quite a bit from day to day. As I walked from Ginza Station to the Tsukiji Outer Market, I couldn't help but notice how similar Ginza is to Yorkville in Toronto, where the majority of upscale brands have set up shop everywhere. Except this is far more elegant and majestic. Also, on the street, you could find local white collars everywhere that wear mostly suits and dress in an office environment. I noticed that there are no trash cans in sight, and the streets are incredibly clean. You either have to carry the trash home, or the Japanese don't encourage eating outside. If you know why, please share it in the comment section below. Really curious about. It was a good 10-minute walk before finally approaching Tsukiji Outer Market. This is definitely a sunny day. Let's see what we can find for some market food and snacks. I'm going to go through the street somewhat in detail, and I hope when I look back I can see it and experience it all over again. I hope you can follow along, and feel free to skip it for other part of my day vlog if you wish. Seafood is the main attraction in this market, but they also sell unique restaurants, equipment such as knives. Used to be wholesale seafood market, but now in this outer market, it has become a tourist attraction area where you can also find many souvenirs. looking back, I should have tried this king crab soup along with those abalone on the other side. The raw meat ranging from 1,400 to 2,000 yen looks awesome. That's about $12 to $18 Canadian during my stay. Fatty eel with rice looks awesome. I was craving one of those. However, for those that don't know me, I don't eat any raw fish or meat, so don't be disappointed if I'm not showing any great sashimi for this market. I know that is somewhat of an injustice to this place. Apparently, this kind of egg omelette is also very popular here. It tastes somewhat sweet. These are some of the uni topico bean curds that my wife would like to try it again. More on that later on. There were many shops that sell those egg omelets, and many were lining up for them. These candy, grapes, and strawberries looks kind of cute as well. We will try some later. The yogurt ice cream has many flavors, and we will definitely come back again. Now looking back, I regret not trying this grilled squid. It's too bad that I don't have a big belly. Wagyu and Kobe beef were all over the place. It looks delicious. Looking back, I really missed so many snacks, including these grilled scallops, soft shell shrimp, and the octopus. Next is the popular croquette shop. I think the traditional croquette is made of mashed potatoes, onions, and ground meat, but in this store they mainly use cabbage. It is pretty interesting. Let's take a look together. I think we ordered the traditional croquette with bonito flakes. It tastes quite interesting, but I'm not a big fan. There is definitely no lack of varieties of sushi kuni, but like I said earlier, I don't eat those. But they are certainly look great, and there are plenty of eat-in restaurants available. Look at the beautiful Wagyu beef and all sorts of cuts. Just looks so good. And the Wagyu beef with uni on top looks very interesting. There are also many restaurant equipments in this market, as well as many dry snacks. This restaurant of seafood and sushi looks quite interesting. And they grilled in front of you. Here is the shrimp specialty bar, and there are some scallops as well. Here is a soba, udon, and soup based chop. I definitely missed this and should have gotten one to try these butter grilled scallops. Apparently, these meat chops look great, and they were advertised as never frozen before. This is supposed to be very fresh, and the quality must be exceptional. It is now approaching the afternoon, and the crowd is much larger inside the market. Grill and Wagyu beef skewers are still one of the main attractions here. Unagi, or eel, is also one of my favorites among the Japanese foods. The grilled scallops, oysters, and crabs looks very interesting here, and they were grilled in front of you. It looks really good. I've seen this figure here and around the market. I think there is some kind of Michelin food status. I don't know, I have no clue what it means. But if anyone knows, leave a comment below. There are also many dry goods such as the octopus, squid, and some sort of fish. We tried a few and they were quite interesting, but we did not end up buying any. Now let's get inside the market. And as usual, there are some drink vending machines and the only public washrooms available. There are more restaurants and shops inside, and there are few eating and sitting areas as well. They also offer to cook any seafood or meat on the spot to ensure everything is fresh. After looking around, let's head back outside and get something to try. We got something with the tofu bean curd on the outside with some uni and tobiko. Obviously, I'm not a fan of these, but this will be the first time my daughter has tasted them. Tell, she's not also a fan of that. You can also find fresh vegetables in the market. Here are more seafood, unagi skewers, and A5 Wagyu skewers available. Now is the time to try one of these popular items in this market, which are the strawberries and grapes on the stick. This is worth a try. This is also an ice cream that I would recommend. It tastes more like a yogurt ice cream, and it was creamy and delicious. It is somewhat rich, but not too overpowering, but I'm quite satisfied. This is the unagi rice bowl, and it is about 1,500 yen, or about $13 Canadian. After the morning at Tsujiki Outer Market, we are back to Ginza. And while we are there, we don't want to miss the flagship Uniqlo. This is the largest Uniqlo store in the world, Uniqlo Ginza. This Uniqlo spans across 12 floors and is absolutely worth a visit. Let's explore it together, shall we? Not only is it the flagship, but the renovation and decoration are second to none. Whether your intent is to shop or not, this is worth a visit. As a Canadian myself, or if you are an international tourist, it is tax-free. And compared that to the prices in Canada, I find it quite cheaper too. Thank you. After shopping at the Uniqlo flagship store, we couldn't help but take pictures of the Ginza area around here. All the flagship stores look incredible. Next stop from Ginza Station, we are heading to the nearest station, Kamiyasho Station, to Team Lab Borderless. Basically, Team Lab Borderless is a now popular tourist destination specifically for artworks that involve all sorts of shapes, lights, and forms. We have the reservation done before coming to Japan, and we will see it momentarily. Before that, we are going to pass by the Asaburai Hills, which were completed just recently in 2023. This complex lies between the Mori Building Project and Roppongi Hills to the west. This building now hosts world-class art museums, Michelin star restaurants, and lots of luxury shopping destinations. Unfortunately, Google was not updated yet, but I will show you along the way to Team Lab Borderless, which is located at the Mori Building right here. Let's explore it together. This is Kamiyasho Station, and we are on the way to the Mori Building to Team Lab Borderless. Look at the architectural design of this building. This is the Asaburai Hills Mall that connects to the Mori Building. And in fact, these buildings were just completed in 2023. So the entire area is relatively new. I love the design and the vibe of the entire neighborhood. The trip up to the hills was really clean and looked astonishing. As you can see, the shops look fantastic and upscale. There are still condo buildings under development, and the surrounding area looks amazing and new. Luxury brands such as Dior and Cartier already have stores in this Asaburai Mall. There are plenty more luxury brand stores around the area, and many more Michelin-starred restaurants and eateries surrounding the art and museums. Now let's find our way into Team Lab Borderless through the Mori Building. Walk by, we notice a big lineup to this buffet inside the Asaburai Hills Market. This must be a popular buffet restaurant since there was such a lineup going in. finally, we made it to the Team Lab Borderless. Let's have some fun. Right at the entrance, we see a large room full of colorful flowers like surrounding us. It simply looks amazing. This would be a great test for the Osmo Pocket 3 in low light conditions. I hope it can keep up, but I'm certain it's already better than most cell phones. Comment below what you think about the image quality of the Pocket 3 in these extreme low light situations. Let's explore together, and I will leave some of the clips with the sounds coming straight from the Team Lab Borderless. Let me know how this sound too, straight from the Osmo Pocket 3 internal mic. This is one of the areas that I find most interesting. The range of lights will go according to the person standing on it, just like actual heavy raindrops. The effects are quite interesting, where they can sense the person and adjust the lighting. This just looks like a waterfall of lights. head back to Shinjuku and have dinner. Supposed to have another restaurant in mind, but we decided not to wait anymore. I have to take my own seat while my wife and daughter have their other seats separately. Otherwise, we will have to wait much longer. I find this self-made grilled beef quite interesting. You have all the condiments on the side and your own hot water tap for your tea as well. Order a beef and a pork combo. There is rice, some sort of pork, marinated beef with some onions, some kimchi, and a seaweed soup. Finished my dinner early while my wife and daughter were still taking the time for dinner. Now I have some time to walk for a bit and once again test out the Osmo Pocket 3 with the quarter mist filter. What do you think? Now in post, I think I quite like it, especially the glow on the neon lights. Anyway, I'll see you on the final day in Tokyo in the next part before heading to Osaka. See ya!